Methodist Church, and happy Memorial Day. When I say happy Memorial, it's kind of bittersweet because we're all remembering people who have passed. And I always think it's a very weird holiday to say happy. But anyway, it is a happy time because we think back at our, you know, family and friends that have passed, and we remember them. So tomorrow's Memorial Day. School in Pinellas County is out. It's totally out now. It used to go on for a couple more weeks. No, they are out. So everyone drive carefully, and trust me, those kids are out there, and they will, you just got to watch out for them. You have to be a really defensive driver, or they will get you. So just drive carefully, please. Also this week, Pride Month starts on June 1st, and this is like the 20th anniversary in St. Pete. It's the largest LGBTQ plus.
LGBTQ.
LGBTQ plus celebration in the country. I've been practicing that. But yeah, there's all kinds of activities. Just go online, there's parades, there's concerts, there's, you know, you name it, they got it. This coming Saturday, June 4th, is the Pride, Raise Pride Day. So if you're interested in the raise and celebrating Pride, that's a great way to do it. It's 4 o'clock on the 4th, so just contact the raise. Last year we went as a group. I'm not doing that. It's too hard when you have to have the tickets on your phone for me to do that. So, but please, go online and celebrate Pride, as we all will do. This is the fifth Sunday, so I hope you took an envelope for the children's home. They've been in business for 114 years. It's not an easy business, but they do a fine job. So we're taking a special offering for the Children's Home Society. There's a new birthday card idea. As you walked in, you saw a table full of cards. Those are the June birthdays and anniversaries, and if you feel like signing them, please do so. Usually I just send them out in the mail, and I just thought this was a great idea, which I got from Pastor Lorraine, and that's, she's the King of Peace Hospitality Sunshine person. So I hope you like that idea, and when you come in, you might want to just scribble a few words to your friends. We have a meeting next Sunday right after worship in the fellowship hall. And don't forget to sign up for Pastor Bob's brunch. That's the end of June, and that will be the last time Pastor Bob is preaching, and we want to celebrate his retirement, he and Ginny's retirement, and best wishes to them. So everybody, mark your calendars for the last Sunday in June. And this week we have just one anniversary, and it's our anniversary. And I just want to say, 49 years, miracles do happen. And don't forget to pick up your hurricane guide. Thank you, James, for these, and they're in the back. And let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you, Gloria. Okay. Can you hear me okay? I'm sorry that it was necessary for you to get reservations today, but I'm glad you were able to do so and be here. It's Memorial Day weekend, and always we have a lot of people who travel in our way, but I'm glad that we can be here together. As you know, we've been busy for the last couple of weeks trying to move in to our new place in Gainesville. We looked and we had the place entirely livable. Everything we needed was in, and there were still 35 boxes in the garage. And that was after we had weeded everything out and left it for an estate sale. And it's just the stuff you accumulate. If you open a box now, it's kind of like it's a surprise. Oh, I didn't know I had that, or forgot I had that. It's been fun to be near our granddaughters. I have one granddaughter that anytime I need to get someplace, I call her for directions. The other granddaughter, every time my phone doesn't work right, I call her. And they are the sweetest, kindest granddaughters in the whole world. I love them to death. They sometimes look at us wondering how we have managed to stay alive because there's so little we know. And actually, they're probably correct. So, anyway, let's join together in prayer. Most gracious Lord, we do thank you for this beautiful day, and we thank you for this time together in worship. As we approach this month that is set aside to celebrate Pride, we pray that as a church, we are living out that message that the gospel is for all. And we hope that and pray that we live out that statement we make that says all are welcome and all means all. Teach us to be loving of all of your children, even if we don't understand always who people are and how people are so different. But teach us that they are your children. As we gather this morning, we pray that your Holy Spirit will rest upon us, and that your Spirit will draw us close to you and close to one another. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we're going to sing some songs today. Now we're back to our CDs. David used up all of our organ energy and it's gone. So let's see, we're going to start with number 338, where he leads me, I will follow, and we'll do all of the verses.
Yeah.
take a moment just to reflect upon and think upon. And they're not pleasant issues, but we need to be aware of them, and we need to think about our response. I am hoping and I am praying that this is the last time I will ever have to address from a pulpit a mass shooting. I have done so too many times, as far as I'm concerned. 21 people, 19 of them children, none of those children over 10 years of age. Their lives were taken. And there will be all kinds of finger pointing that there was a failure to recognize the signals in this young man, that there was a failure in the police on how they reacted, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What won't be acknowledged is that this is an American problem. It does not exist in other countries. I just read this morning, and I'm not sure if I have these numbers reversed. As I recall reading it, in the last 16 days, there were 10 other mass shootings. They just didn't get reported because it becomes a mass shooting, I believe, if at least four are injured and two or three of them are dead. But they just, you know, you don't have the time to report when we only killed three or four people. And it could have been in the last 10 days or 16. I don't remember. The United States Congress, I suspect, will repeat its total irresponsibility in that they will talk and point fingers at one another. And the right will say this is the fault, the left will say that is the fault, and they will go on and on and on and on. And pretty soon it will die down, and they will have accomplished nothing. The truth of the matter is that there are none of us that know what the answer to this really is. And most likely, if there's an answer, and maybe it's too late with the number of guns we have around, but if there's an answer, it is probably multifaceted. And it comes from thoughts from the right and from the left. My concern is this. It's not that people don't understand exactly what to do and disagree on what would be the best response, at least at the head of the spear. My concern for this country is that we do nothing. We do nothing. We don't do anything to control the access to guns. We don't do anything to identify early people who have the potential to do this. We don't do anything to increase and improve mental health treatments to possibly prevent it. We don't do anything. And as long as we do nothing, and as long as we continue to elect or re-elect congressional leaders that will be comfortable doing nothing, we will continue to be the only country in the world that slaughters its children and accepts it. I've long said that we lost our soul, and I still believe this, the day that 20-some children were killed in San Diego. We, in essence, said when that was over, we can live with that. We can replace those children. And it is my fear, it is my expectation that we'll do the same thing. 19 children was less. I think God would be understanding if we tried something and it didn't work. If we do nothing, seems to me to be so contrary to what God would want. We like to talk about this country, and you can tell I'm approaching the end of my time because I would get run out of town for saying this. We like to approach, and we have been for a number of years, that America is the greatest country on earth. I do not believe a country has a right to refer to itself as great when we do nothing about shooting our children. And that's exactly what we have done. So, I suggest that we be prayerful, but trust me, when we say to that community, you are in our thoughts and our prayers, doesn't mean anything to them. They couldn't care less. Because they will look at us and say, you can pray all you want, but you won't take any action. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Number 348, we will do verses 1, 2, and 4.
Freedoms to practice our religion, and the freedom without any censorship, the freedom for freedom of speech, and there's so many different freedoms we have. There's no way to ever thank all the people who have done this for us. For me, as I walked through Arlington Cemetery and saw all of the headstones and all of those who have given their life for our country, it made me have a sense of sadness, but at the same time, a sense of joy. The joy was that we knew that each and every one of them willfully gave their lives for us. And to know that they did that is something that is a sense of joy, while sadness is a prominent feature. So at this time, I'd like to say a prayer, not only for them, but for all of those throughout the country that are suffering. As Pastor Bob said, there was many shootings within the past 10 days. So I think his numbers are actually a little low, but that is sad, extremely sad. If we're killing each other, and then we complain about a war in the Ukraine where another country is killing people, we're killing each other here in our own country. So God, we come for you this time. We thank you for this opportunity to meet and to pray and to have you here with us. Whether online or here in person, God, you and the Holy Spirit is here. You are with us always. We are never alone. No matter how alone we might feel, we can just go to you in prayer and feel the peace that only you, through the Holy Spirit, can give us. Guide and direct us. Be with all the families of all the loved ones who have lost persons in the military, and all those who have lost persons for any reason. Because God, we know there's a good part to this, because they are with you in heaven. That is what we're promised to. While our time here on earth is relatively short, to the eternity that we're going to spend with you, without sickness, sorrow, or death, and without worry or strife, we thank you, God, for sending your Son into the world, because you loved us so much that you wanted a way, and you came to the earth incarnate in the body of Jesus to save us from our sins and rebellions against you. We can never praise and thank you enough, God. We need to remember to give thanks each and every day for the good things we have in our lives, and to thank you for the fact that we are alive when we get up in the mornings. God, I ask that you be with all of those who are sick, and extend your healing hand, all those who are on our prayer list, and all those who unspoken prayers need your healing. God, be with our first responders, our law enforcement, our health care workers, and all of our military, past, present, and especially those who are in harm's way, in any of these categories, so that they may return safely to us. God, we thank you for all the things you have done for us. We thank you and give praise to you and honor. Now let us pray the prayer that Jesus gave to his disciples when he was here. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Thank you, David. Well, there's another issue I want to touch base with. Been away a couple of weeks, so I missed a chance to preach my kind of mini-sermons. It appears, we do not know, but it appears that the Supreme Court is going to overturn a guiding legal principle that has been in place for over half a century, with a reversal of Roe versus Wade. This issue, I think, has been an issue we have tried to simplify over the last half century. We have simplified it from the concept of just it's my body, my choice, whatever I can do. And we simplified it on the other extreme by saying life begins at inception. That is what a court in Oklahoma has now passed. That from the time of fertilization, I think is the term they had used. Probably at the time of fertilization, it's a little difficult to define and to describe what has happened as a complete autonomous life that is being destroyed. On the other hand, it's probably just as foolish, maybe more so, to think someone should be allowed to choose to have an abortion a week before their due date. That both of those extremes. And obviously, we're dealing with a very, very complex moral issue of when is a life viable? When does a fetus become a living human being? And that's not an easy question to answer. And I think we should try to struggle with that question rather than struggle out on the extremes. And I do understand people having very, very different opinions on the issue of abortion. It's one that it's easy for me to understand the ambiguity and the difficulty. I get a little frustrated when it's dealt with just again. Let's just pick the argument that probably doesn't make a whole lot of sense on either side and just become militant about it. We need to continue to struggle with that issue. And there's obviously going to have to be complex decisions made. But here's my problem. My problem isn't that we have to struggle with the issue of abortion. My problem is that we use the term pro-life. We're not pro-life. We're pro-birth. And as a country, we don't give a damn what happens to those children who are born into poverty, who are born into settings where no human being should have to exist. We couldn't care less as long as there was no abortion from day one on. And I will never, ever be able to support what is called the pro-life position until it moves beyond the pro-birth position. Until we take seriously, I become so frustrated listening to the reality of blaming poverty on the poor. We have an income disparity in this country that threatens to undo it. We have people who make billions, and yet we can't come up with a willingness to ensure that all of our, one out of four children in the state of Florida are food insecure. Insecure about having enough food for the day. And as a country, again, I don't know how we think we can call our country great when we allow so many families and children to suffer when we have the resources to prevent that. We have the resources. Well, they should get up and take care of themselves. They should be doing this and doing that. I did. Guess what? Maybe they're not as smart as you. Maybe they didn't grow up in good homes. Maybe they're lazy. Maybe they are to blame for their poverty. I don't care. I never see the text I'm preaching on today follows the story of Jesus feeding the 5,000. I don't recall recall any place in the story that Jesus went around and said, do you have a job? Well, you should be working, no food for you. Have you been too lazy to prepare meals for your kids? No food for your kids. I never saw Jesus going around and asking the question, do you deserve my help? My head's going to explode here in a minute. Have we not learned that if any of us received what we deserve from God, we'd be toast? We expect, we almost demand, God, be gracious unto us. But we sure aren't going to give grace to those people because they're irresponsible. So they have the baby, it's their responsibility, and I'll take care of it, not ours. I don't know where you stand on the abortion issue. I frankly hope that for every one of us, our stance is, wow, I don't know for sure. Here's where I'll try to come down, but God be met. I don't really know for sure because I don't really know when life does begin. And boy, it becomes a different issue if there's a before and after. But regardless of that, I hope that we will pray that we as a people, we as a country, can begin to say our focus needs not to be simply on do we allow abortion. Our focus needs to be that we are going to be pro-life, not just pro-birth. Again, I don't know. I'm frankly filled with angst this week, so you are the recipients of that. Okay. I think we've sung all. Did we sing I Am Thine, O Lord? We just do it. All right, let's just do that. I Am That, Thine, O Lord. 419. We'll do verses 1, 2, and 4. Then I'll get on with just doing a sermon, okay?
I have heard thy voice and dwell by.
went to see, went to Tampa to see my granddaughter play in a soccer tournament. And the second granddaughter was playing in a soccer tournament in Lakewood Ranch. I went to the Tampa one. And for the game Saturday, I was showing her, I bought a new water bottle. And it's really great. I can hold on to it, and I can pop it open. And, you know, I really like it. She says, do you have water in there, Papa? I says, no, we have Diet Pepsi in there. And she rolled her eyes at me. Oh, Papa, you're supposed to drink water. Water is for bathing. And that's the purpose of water. But anyway. Join me in prayer. Lord, we do thank you for the opportunity to be here, to worship you. Thank you for those who are online with us this morning, for those who will see us later today or during the week. We thank you for that opportunity. We ask your blessings upon us. We ask your spirit to open our hearts and our minds as the scriptures are read and the word proclaimed. We may hear with joy and with understanding the things you will say to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, it's been kind of these past couple weeks that I have been realizing the end of my time in a regular Sunday pulpit is drawing to a close. I will be here next week, and then actually we will be gone again for a couple weeks. We're going to Pennsylvania to see our oldest granddaughter graduate from high school. And we are excited about that. Our youngest, well, of our Florida grandchildren, our youngest granddaughter and her father will be leaving in a couple of weeks for Kenya. And they will be going on a mission team that is going to be in Kenya. The older sister got to do that 2 years ago. But my daughter and the oldest granddaughter are going to meet us in Pennsylvania. They will fly up after annual conference. I called our district superintendent and said, I'm not going to be at annual conference. And she said, well, then I could fire you. I said, yeah, you could. I shouldn't say that. But, and then we're going to go together up into New York to visit the church camp that I grew up going to, and that and I've had the chance to be the camp pastor a couple times as I've been a pastor. But I started attending that camp in 1954 and went as a student to summer camp every year until I graduated from high school. And it is, for me, the most sacred space on earth. It is where it will be Jenny and my final resting place. So it's we're looking forward to that. And then we will be back for the 26th. So I actually only have a couple Sundays to do a regular kind of sermon. And I decided that I was going to use the text that are the two favorite stories, my two favorite stories in the scriptures. I probably preached on both of them at one time or another. In fact, the one I'll preach on next year, I know I preached on within the past 6 months, but most of us are the age we can't remember what we heard anyway, so it doesn't matter. But that the first one that I will preach on is my favorite story of scripture. I read to you the story of Jesus and Peter as they meet upon the water. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. Jesus and the disciples have been on the western shore of Galilee, and they're going to take a boat to the eastern shore, which now are known as the Golan Heights. And Syria, and they will preach over there. I think I'm a little hot. That mic can come down just a tad. So anyway, after he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves, because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and they cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," Jesus said. And Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Fascinating story. Let's start from the beginning. Of all the disciples on the boat, all but one of them did the smartest thing. They stayed on the boat. I don't care what you're doing, if you're in the middle of the sea, and the Sea of Galilee, while not big, can get really rough. If you're in a boat and the winds are going, and even if you are pretty convinced that that's Jesus walking to you, the smart thing to do, trust me, is stay in the boat. But Peter, who is very often not the sharpest knife in the dishwasher, Peter, who, he's got a record. Peter decides to say, "Lord, if that's you, call to me and I'll do that." And I can just see the other disciples sitting there and shaking their head, saying, "Here goes Peter again. This is going to be a mess, I guarantee you." And so Peter gets out of the boat. And because he was the foolish believer, not the believer who still had to use a lot of wisdom, he became, to the best of our knowledge, besides Jesus, the only person in history who's ever walked on water. I don't imagine he forgot that experience. I don't know if Peter ever had grandchildren, but I guarantee you if he did, he'd tell them that one. That would be one of his best stories. Well, as the story unfolds, Peter's walking out of the water, and he begins to look around, and as I suspect it was common with Peter, he would look around and he'd say, "Oh, I'm not sure I made the right decision. This doesn't really look good." And he begins to go down. And he kind of yells to Jesus, "Jesus, help me. I made a bad choice here." And Jesus reaches out his hand and lifts him up, said, "You have little faith, why did you doubt?" Now, the way we generally interpret that is Jesus is saying, "You have little faith, you did not have the faith that you could continue to walk on water, and that's why you sunk." I don't think that's what Jesus meant. I think Jesus was probably saying later, "Peter, good job. I'm certainly not surprised that you began to look around and think that this wasn't wise. That's, you know, that's kind of the human response, and you began to go down. Peter, why did you doubt that I would save you? I was quite sure you would eventually begin to sink, but I also knew I wouldn't let you go under. And I'd take your hand, and I'd pull you out, and we'd go back to the boat." And then those who saw it had just a little bit more insight as to who this Jesus fellow really was. Because, you know, that was a question that they were trying to ask throughout his ministry. That was a question that I'm sure burned in the depth of their soul. And we see that they do not have a fully developed idea. They'll get the language at times, but it'll take the whole ministry for them to really, it'll take resurrection for them to really say, wow, we do know who this was. Now, the reason I like that text is because I think there's some significant stories for us. Sometimes the wisest thing we can do is to play it safe. You can talk to any pastor, and we'll tell you about how we very often have had to play it safe, not say what we really wanted to say, not do what we really wanted to do. We just said, no, we better not do that. Better make the safe choice. And for the most part, it pays off. But we also can look back and say, wow, there are some times I missed walking on water just because I wanted to play it safe. Just because I didn't want to take the chance that I might say something, I might do something. And gee, before you knew it, there'd be a staff parish committee asking the district superintendent to move me. Or whatever. I suspect that everyone in this room can look back at the times we played it safe. There were storms brewing, and we better take the safe option. If we're lucky, on the other hand, if we're lucky, there may have been some times that we didn't play it safe. That we took the chance and we got out of the boat. And let me tell you what. In those brief little moments that you're walking on water, it is a trip. In those brief little moments that you feel I am at a oneness with God and serving Him and doing what He wants and taking the chance. At those moments when just, if it's not specifically involved in ministry, you're taking a chance in life that God will walk with you. Maybe it's the new job, it's whatever. And when you find yourself, it's working, what a thrill. But here's also a reality. There's probably times you took a chance, you took a few steps on the water, and you began to sink. You said, uh-oh, maybe I shouldn't have done that. Now, I'm not saying that it's going to be easy, but what I've learned, and I've had a lot of those experiences, what I've learned is that, in reality, God has never let me go under. That God's promise to be faithful to me, to be gracious unto me, to love me, has never, ever failed. I may have had a worldly failure. I may have gone down a dusty trail that was very hurtful and destructive. Sometimes it's taken a long time for that hand that Jesus is reaching out to actually pull me up. But pull me up, He has done. And sometimes He's had to say to me, and you know, when I think back, it's generally with a smile on his face, why did you doubt? I knew when you went down that trail, you probably weren't going to make it. But I was not going to let you sink. I was not going to desert you. There's nothing that can separate you from my love. You know, I look around and we have a similarity. None of us are children anymore. Some of us are further down the road than others. Some of us are dealing with stuff that is really scary. And sometimes the wisdom of the world will be just simply play it safe. But I don't care where you are in life, there's going to be times that God is going to say, here's an opportunity to step out of the boat. You want to play it safe, don't. But if you want to get out of that boat, you got an opportunity to walk on the water. And that's pretty exciting at any age, at any stage of life. Will you succeed all the time?
Yeah.
Of course not. Just keep it in your mind. If you got 1 out of 3 and you were a baseball player, you'd be in the Hall of Fame. Go for it. Have the courage to listen to God's call. He will not let you sink. He will be faithful to you throughout your life and throughout eternity. Trust Him. Pray with me. Lord, nobody, to the best of our knowledge, has ever done what Peter did. What a thrill it must have been. He got scared. He faltered. Don't we all? But you would not let him go. You pulled him back up and continued on the journey. May we have such a faith that we will take that chance, that we won't always just say what's the safest route. We will instead say, what can we do? Teach us to trust that even when we falter, and falter we will do, but even when we falter, you are there to grab hold of us. Each of our journeys will look different. Each of our journeys will face different difficulties and different opportunities. May we always continue to put our trust in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tomorrow is Memorial Day. David mentioned that in his prayers. And, you know, Gloria said it's a day of mixed feelings.
Bittersweet.
Yeah, bittersweet. I have been downrange. I spent my year in Vietnam, and I know and experienced what it was like to lose people you knew. And Memorial Day is always a different and unique experience. I do give thanks for all those who have had to answer and deal with maybe the most sinful thing we do as humans, and that's to go to war. And yet, I've seen the greatest examples of human courage and honor amongst those who have served. As any place I have ever been. I give thanks for those who gave their all, lost their life, and didn't return home. I deal with anger that we allow ourselves over and over and over and over again to get into that position. you can kind of tell, I've really got some anger and frustration going on in my life right now at how wantonly we deal with the destruction of human life. None of God's creation kills one another like we do. So I say to you, may it be a day of memorializing. Enjoy the freedom that has been given to you in this country. And remember those who made that sacrifice. Let's close with a hymn. It's, again, one of my favorites. Number 593, Here I Am, Lord. I was going to do all verses, but we don't have time. Let's do the first and the third verse. So everybody brought their food, and the first thing we did was collect the food. And then we had the service. And we had said, we're providing all the stuff, you don't need to worry about it. What they had done is they went into the back and they prepared the food that the people brought. And the food that they had bought for the Thanksgiving dinner went to the food bank. I think we had about 27 cans of gonzo beans, and we had two cans of sauerkraut, and people had emptied their their stuff to prepare it, and that's what they got for Thanksgiving dinner, and the good food went to the poor. It was just, it was one of those memories that was quite special. Go in peace. May today, tomorrow be a special day. For those of you who worship with us online, thank you for being here. May God bless you.